respected Bishop Marwe, as my spiritual brother, and respected mayor, and my friend, these two young ladies,
sisters,
two sisters, and then some respected teachers, and also I think leaders, and spiritual brothers, sisters. Indeed, I am very, very happy to be here. Actually, this is first time, although New York City, quite a number of occasions, I visit different part of New York City, but this is first time. I think not my sort of negligence, but no invitation. So this time I received the invitation. So naturally, when we receive some invitation, and if you refuse that, it is foolish. So happy to accept that invitation and to come and meet some new people and make new friends, and also have opportunity to share some of my own sort of belief and thoughts on the basis of my own experience. So I'm very happy. And then also, as soon as my plane touched down, I stayed to the state senators.
Senate chamber.
And I met, I think, full of friendship, sort of full of friendly atmosphere. So, I expressed there one joke I mentioned there. I always have, since my childhood, I have the sort of habit, I always feel more closer to the weaker side. So I express the Republicans are minority, so I have some sympathy towards them. And then all the Republican members, you see, very kasota, I think, stand up and express very joyful. Then I told them, this is a joke. Not serious. So I think that is really greatness of democratic system. One time, one party, another time, another party. So I think this is a very, very healthy sign. And very good. Although I think two parties, this seems not much a big differences, but simply name, democratic, Republicans. But some competition, that's good. That's a healthy sign. Then, this is my last day of this time, sort of, my visit here.
To the United States. To the United States.
To the United States. Now, tomorrow early morning, I'm leaving. It was my home, second home, India. An overnight stop at London. So, almost now 2 weeks in this country, I had many occasions meeting with public and also some students or professors, some scientists. I also learned some new things. So indeed, I am very, very satisfied. And also many occasions meeting with media people, very friendly. So, and also the having the opportunity to share some of my thought. So my main talk everywhere, whether in America, whether in India, whether in Africa, everywhere, in Europe, everywhere, in Japan, everywhere, I always talk the best way, effective way to bring inner strength. With that, inner calmness or inner peace. And with that, we can handle all problems more realistically, more effectively. So I believe warm-heartedness, compassionate heart, is the key factor for meaningful life. And also for one's own health, the calm mind, one very, very crucial factor. According to my own experience, when I had medical checkup from time to time, the doctors found my physical condition is very good. So of course my life not happy one, lot of difficulties. At age 16, I lost my freedom. At age 24, I lost my own country. Then last 50 years, constant heartbreaking news, always. Some cases, some positive news, otherwise most cases, bad news, sad news. But then, comparatively, my mental state quite okay, quite calm. So now this shows, I think, some impact in my health. So some people consider Dalai Lama have some kind of healing power. That's nonsense. If I truly have sort of healing power, then the surgery which remove my gallbladder, that should not take place. So that means very clear I have no healing power. So logically, it is rather foolish if anyone have some healing power, then firstly, use himself or herself. So I think the peace of mind really makes differences about our health and day-to-day life more happier. And one's own inner happiness, inner calmness, also creates some peaceful atmosphere. That also many other people enjoy. So through that way, we can create more happier society. Something like one family. That we really need. Money, power, may not bring that. That thing can bring only through sincere, compassionate attitude. Even animals, I think sometimes, I think we should, because we can learn more things from animal rather than human being. The animals, they don't care whether that person is rich or poor, whether that person is this color, this religion or non-believer. They do not know, don't care. But they care very much, their other person's sort of attitude.
Affection.
Affectionate attitude. Sincere, not lying, not cheating. Then these animals also very much appreciate, like dogs, cats, and some birds also. So here I have still this one question. Whether mosquitoes have the ability to appreciate of others' affection? That still I don't know. And some small insect, they may not have the ability. Their brain size is too small. So they are only sort of, equipped for just day-to-day survival or day-to-day life. That's all. But many cases, even animals also have the appreciate others' truthfulness, honesty, compassion. So then we, human beings, suppose we have much more intelligence. If that intelligence destroyed or negligence about this basic value, which even other animals also appreciate, if that we neglect or minimize, it's not intelligent sort of act. It's something foolish. I think basically our nature, I believe, more compassionate. One killer sign is, firstly, we everybody come from mother's womb and we survived with mother's milk. So at that time, immense affection from our mother. And our side also totally relying on mothers, on mother. At that time, we have no idea who is that person. But we do appreciate affection, smile, closeness feeling. So then we trust that, totally rely on that. So according to medical doctor, after birth, next few weeks, mother's physical touch is very crucial factor for proper development of brain of the child. Then, obviously, I think in this hall, some people there, that very strong light, you see, I cannot see. Yes. So, I think in this hall, perhaps 2,000, 3,000? 3,000. Over nearly 300,000. I mean 3,000, nearly 3,000. My English, dangerous. So now nearly 3,000 people here. I think if we examine those individuals who at the young age who receive maximum affection from our mother, their mental state comparatively much more stable. And more important, such people a greater potential to show affection to other. Greater ability to show affection to other. And I think 24 hours, such people are more happier, more calm. May not disturb their mind easily. Then those people, I think there must be some, at a young age, lacking that affection. And worst case, some abuse. Then, abuse from the emotionally nearest person, then they really lost affection. So instead of feeling affection, but fear, distrust. As a result, those people who had such experience at a young age, I think, may find more difficult to feel of others' pain. So as a result, such people, their mind constantly some kind of, in deep inside, some kind of fear.
Insecurity.
As a result, small sort of problem can disturb much their mind. Then another, according to the medical scientist, they say, anger, hatred, or constant anger, hatred, fear, is actually eating our immune system. More calm mind, compassionate mind, can increase this immune system. So there's one particular sort of particle in our body. What do you call that?
I think there's a technical term for a part of the immune system. There's a cell. It looks like a tail. I think it's called telomerase.
I don't know.
Telomerase.
I don't know. So one occasion in medical sort of conference. So they actually show some picture. I remember that picture. It is some something, what the pulses of shit is.
It looks a bit like a kind of a tadpole, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So at the top is something there. So those animal who lacking the affection or lack of sort of
care,
affectionate surrounding. Much less that.
Shorter. The tail is shorter.
And then animal, two animal, another animal, just licking.
Licking.
That immense sort of effect on others, did this matter. So that actually, you see, demonstrated at one conference. So, just our discussion with some medical scientist or psychiatrist, psychotherapist at Boston University.
Harvard
University, yes, Harvard University. You see, we...
Harvard Medical School.
Harvard Medical School. You see, we attach these points, like that. So these are now scientifically, I say, make clear for physical health, mental state is a very crucial factor. So therefore, the concept of warm-heartedness, concept of a compassionate attitude or compassion, is not simply a religious matter. It's a universal value. Whether accept religion or not, that's up to individual. Of course, those people who sincerely practice one's own faith, their faith immense help to increase this deeper value. So, my commitment is promoting religious harmony. So I fully committed about that, and sincerely respect or appreciate of other traditions. So some of my Christian friend consider me as a good Christian. One time in Australia, on my public talk, one Christian minister introduced me, and while he described me as a good Christian, like that. So, and some Indian, Northern India, in Jammu Kashmir state, traditionally, some Muslim, even they touch one non-Muslim's sort of clothes. Sometimes they wash. They never eat together. But last now, nearly 50 years, I passing through this area. So then those Muslims invite me. I always, as I mentioned earlier, I always accepted their invitation. So you see, having meal with them, oh, very delicious. So you see, I have no feeling of sort of differences. So it really benefit to both sides. I myself also feel, oh, we are same human being. We are same sort of a believer or what to call. I mean, we are same who accept some deeper human values. They also feel very close with me. If we remain on the basis of faith, they are Muslim, we are Buddhist, remain distant, what use? More worry, more feeling of isolation, then it can translate frustration, anger, then violence. Any violence, violent action, is mutual destruction. So like that, so the religious harmony. Of course, the one's own tradition have a certain sort of philosophical view. That's our own business. Some of my Christian friend, one Christian brother, who always showing interest about Buddhism. Yes, There are common practice of compassion, practice of forgiveness, tolerance, contentment, self-discipline, common practice. There are common practice, so we can share in these common sort of practice. We also can learn from Christian brothers, sisters, or some practice. Very useful. And especially if the Christian brothers, sisters very much involved in the social service in the form of education and health. Some remote area in India, some missionary workers, see really the dedicated well-being of the local tribes or local poor people, local community. Sometimes we Buddhist monks, nuns, traditionally remain monastery or nunnery, not much contact with service community. So there we have to learn the experience from other tradition. So similarly, some Buddhist technique quite useful for some Christian practitioner. Certain technique for one single pointed mind, like that, and some method, some technique, promotion of love, compassion, forgiveness, like that. So you see, one occasion, that late Catholic brother, because he also showing interest about Buddhist concept, Buddhist unique concept of emptiness. Then since I know him, we know very well, so I told him, this is Buddhist business, not your business. That I think, you see, his side also, you see, can say about God, Creator, that's the Christian business, not Buddhist business, like that. So in the philosophical field, there's differences. But that's better in order to satisfy a variety of people. These different approach is necessary. So in human history, at different time, different sort of geography, area, these different teachings, you see, develop. It is suit for a variety of people. So it is necessary. Now look, even Tibetan community, basically Buddhist, but still some Muslims there, some Christian also there. So this shows variety among the people. So one of my sort of main commitment is promotion of religious harmony. So all religion, you see, carrying the same message or same potential. But my main sort of effort is without touching religious concept, simply using scientific data and our common experience. And on that basis, make known, make clear, public, we have this inner value, it's immense beneficial. Now, for example, I often used to telling people this global economic crisis. Many people disturbed. And of course, ordinary people also get some sort of impact in their daily life. But here, I believe, and of course, you have to watch, you have to sort of check that those people who think only money value, always think about money like that, no other interest, no other sort of values. And someone who not only, I mean, who also is accept value of money. Certainly, without money, you can't sort of survive. You can't work. Important, but beside money value, material value, the other value, such as happy family, compassionate family, compassionate community, inner peace. Those people, now two people, two kind of people. I think this global economic crisis, I think most hit those person who think only money value, I think hit most. They, I think, get much disturbances than the other one. Other one, yes, no money crisis there, but still very happy in their family, in their community. So that really makes differences. So therefore, in modern time, I think basic modern education system itself pay attention only brain development, not enough pay attention about inner value. I think when about 1,000 years ago, the separate education institution started in Europe. At that time, I think moral ethics, these take care by church and family. So at that time, separate newly developed education institution take care only brain or education. Now in modern society, eventually the religious sort of influence or also little decrease. And also family values also decline. Then the education institution alone have the responsibility. So therefore, many occasions I express, and also many people agree, now we in modern education system, we need some lesson of moral ethics. Then how to put where? That is, we need more research work. On the basis of universal value, and including some scientific findings, these things. So that my main sort of commitment. Wherever I go, I touch this subject and make known or share with public, that please pay more attention about our inner value. And that value is concerned not difference of color, not difference of social background, whether rich or poor, no differences, and also not depend on faith. Even without faith, these human good quality by birth already there. In fact, compassion, the seed of compassion, is a biological factor. We are a social animal. And on top of that, the very way we grown up need others' care. In order to develop others' sort of enthusiasm, caring, emotionally, there's the need something. That's affection. With affection, then all these care take away. Care. One, I think, example. One occasion, my night long flight, I noticed two couples with two children. One, I think maybe 5-6 years old. So better or easier to manage. One, much smaller. Very difficult to manage that. So after takeoff, I think 2-3 hours, they both, father, mother, they both take care about that young child. Then after 4-5 hours, the father just slept. No sign of a botheration about the child. The mother, whole night, till next sort of morning, whole night, taking care about that difficult child. Crying and make noise. Even the other passenger who want to a little bit of sort of peaceful sleep, much disturbances. So the mother whole night is taking care. Then next morning I notice mother's eye become very red. Like that. So this shows biological factor. Mother have tremendous sort of affection and willing to sacrifice mother's own willing to, face any difficulties, any sort of problems. So that's the human nature. So that is the seed of compassion. But I think it is important to know that compassion is oriented towards kasa, towards attitude, others' attitude, or others' action. So therefore, that so long others' attitude friendly towards you, that kind of compassion can maintain. As soon as their attitude change, then that compassionate attitude could turn hatred. So therefore, and also naturally, that kind of affection cannot extend towards neutral people, and particularly your enemy side, whose attitude is negative to yourself. So that is biased, limited, much mixed with attachment. However, that take as a seed, then through awareness, usually I call, Buddhists call, analytical meditation. Analyze values of compassion and negativeness of anger or discrimination. Through these sort of awareness, you can develop new conviction. Now, for example, all human being, all sentient being, by nature want happiness, do not want suffering. Therefore, every sentient being, particularly every human being, have the right to overcome suffering. Use that reason to develop sense of concern. For oneself also, sort of because of the care or cherishing cherishing oneself, not on based of you yourself kind, not that way, but simply I have right to overcome suffering. Because of that, I have right to overcome suffering and desire. So therefore, that's sort of the reason, 100% the same to other people also. By nature, they do not want suffering, and therefore they have every right to overcome suffering. Using that sort of reason, that logic, then develop sense of concern of well-being of other, including your enemy. As far as their attitude is concerned, big difference. Friend, friendly attitude. Enemy, negative attitude. Neutral people, neutral, nothing. But as far as right is concerned, all are same human being, same sentient being, same have the right to overcome. On that level, develop sense of concern. That is unbiased compassion, not oriented towards attitude, but oriented towards being, or person, or people, person, like that, and unbiased, and infinite, not based on attachment. So when I talk universal compassion, having compassion, the universal value is mainly that kind of compassion, unbiased compassion. That I think through education we can develop that. So compassion in because of difficult periods, difficult time. Now my own experience, my own little experience during now last 60 years, particularly in a difficult period, most reliable friend is within myself. That's compassion. And anyway, cheap. other external means sometimes quite expensive. But and also with effort is to come develop with effort. But these inner value from birth we already have. So no need because of the special effort to borrow, to develop. So simply pay more attention and recognize these are valuable things. So that's my main talk. So those people who feel some sort of interest about my talk, then please pay more attention and further analyze yourself, or investigation, on experiment, then you gain more, I think, deeper experiences. Then those people who may not much have the interest, then no problem. After our talk, when you go outside, forget all these things, then no problem. Then carry your endless problem. You involved that way. Then no problem. I will leave it tomorrow. So I'm going to say bye-bye. Thank you. Now, some questions. Thank you. Now some questions.
There seems to be a lot of confusion about your visit here. Why did so many news sources and even your own New York office said that your visit was canceled?
Oh. Firstly, I received invitation. Then in principle, I accepted. Then I received some, complaints. Request. I should not go there. because it is controversial. Some allegations. And then we carry further investigation. Then finally, including this organization, sort of teacher and his some friend came to see me, Dharamsala. And I discuss, I observed. Basically, they are carrying some kind of movement about ethics. Then, as I mentioned earlier, it is my moral responsibility to support any movement by any person who are working for ethics. Because of today's world, many problems, essentially our own creation. And nobody wants more problems, but due to lack of ethics, lack of principle, this unwanted man-made problem happens. Whether politician, whether businessman, whether religious person, whether anyone, moral principle is very essential, like a backbone. So therefore, I feel it is my moral responsibility. But at the same time, these allegations. So when I met them personally, in Dharamsala, I told them very friendly, very openly, as far as your sort of work for promotion of ethics, I fully support. It is my moral responsibility. But at the same time, those allegations, you must make very clear. If you've done something wrong, you must accept, you must admit, and change, make a correction. If you've not done, make clear all these allegations, truthfully, honestly, openly, transparently. Then some media, I always telling media people, the media people should have long nose, as long as long as the elephant nose and smell in front, behind. That's very important. And make clear to the public what's going on. Whether politician, or with the mayor, or religious people, the bishops, or myself, must sort of watch and make clear public, inform public, provided must be very honest, unbiased, objective. That's important. Sometimes, you see one company financing a newspaper, and then newspaper report a little bit because of the little bit biased. I think not as biased as Chinese propaganda. But sometimes, you see, a little sort of biased sort of version there. Also is happening. That must is avoid. They must be honest, truthful. Now I think in front of, I think the public, I want to tell because of the media people, please carry continuously thorough investigation. all these because of the spot where you have some doubt. Thorough investigation. And those concerned people's side also made clear all your work must be transparent. So that's my view. So I feel no problem. Come here, meet people and talk. Because of some criticism, remain distance, not much use. Come face to face and talk. Because frankly, bluntly, truth always remains truth. So more talk, more investigation, truth become more clear, clear, clear. Like that. So that's my answer.
Next question. I struggle being egoless. Being egoless, being selfless.
I see.
In the here and now, without material attachment in the Western technological and material society. Can you advise how to do this?
That is easy to talk, but difficult to practice. And I think individual case, I think some can do that. And many years ago, in Barcelona, there's one big temple, Montserrat or something. So there, when I visit there, one Catholic monk came. His body, not very big, quite small. I think smaller than me, in any case. Then also, his English very poor. I think poorer than me. So I have more proud to talk with him with my broken English. So I was told, the organizers, I am going to meet one Catholic monk who spent 5 years in the mountain, very much hermit life, very little hot meal, bread, tea, like that. So then I met him, I asked him, I was told, you spent 5 years in the mountain, in hermit life. What kind of practice? And he answered, meditation of life, of love. When he mentioned that, in his eyes, some significant sort of impressive sort of expression. Wonderful. So, later I call him modern Miller Rebbe. Miller Rebbe, I think some may know. Which century? I think 14th century.
Late 11th or 12th century. 12th century.
12th century, yes, 12th century. Very famous hermit. Remained remote mountain, almost like animal, like that. Wild animal, like that. So among Tibetan and refugee community also, some individual practice that way. But that's difficult. And ordinary people, that's impractical. I think better remain in the society and carry some productive work. In the meantime, you see the cultivate compassion and also try to increase in your own society and your own personal lifestyle, more contented one, more simple way. Some Christian monks, nuns, in their monastery or nunnery, their way of life, very simple. The simplicity, wonderful. So such things are, I feel, more practical. Meantime, you should be something useful in the society. That I think better. Yes, then, next question.
It is my understanding that China is propagating lies about Tibetan culture and you. These lies are meant to induce fear and moral outrage against you and the Tibetan people, and the lies effectively change the history of Tibet in the minds of millions of Chinese people. There seems to be a tendency for people to passionately and fearfully change their individual understanding of history. Is there a compassionate way to introduce new information to people, specifically information that strongly conflicts with their internal representation of an entire culture?
Now, this moment, since recent time, I'm appealing to the world community. And just this morning, I had one
interview.
CNN interview. I also mentioned. I take this opportunity. I appealing to the world community. Now, they investigate thoroughly whether Tibetan people are really happy or not inside Tibet. Because the very reason we carry this struggle is we believe, according to information which we received, the things are not happy. Not only just unhappiness, but Tibetan people very much sort of grievance or resentment because of threat of Tibetan unique cultural heritage and the Tibetan spirit. Sometime back, about 15 years ago, new party secretary in autonomous region of Tibet, when he came, one party meeting, he mentioned the ultimate source of threat, Tibet separate from mainland China, is Tibetan Buddhism, Buddhist faith. So, in these hardliner Chinese communists, among the communists also, you see, there are more liberal, more realistic also there. But these hardliners, so long Tibetan unique cultural heritage, including Tibetan unique language and script and Tibetan Buddhist faith, so long these remain there, they see as a source of threat, of separation. So their topmost concern is how to keep Tibet in their hands. So therefore, they deliberately carry some sort of systematic policy. So that brings resentment from Tibetan side. For example, about 2 years ago, I met one Tibetan whose personal things very well.
Personal situation.
A personal situation very well He told me, with his profession, he got very good salary and facility for his children about education and his sort of accommodation. These things he mentioned. Excellent. No worry. And then he mentioned to me, he expressed to me, being as a Tibetan, mentally, emotionally, some kind of suppression there. Then tear in his eyes. So that's the situation. Tibetan, we have our own culture, long history. The Chinese hardliners dismiss these things, consider Tibet very backward. They come to Tibet as a liberation, as a liberator. So that's the problem. So I appeal, please go to Tibet, investigate. And you can ask, I mean, you should ask Chinese officials, I want free access, without any restriction, without Chinese police, without Chinese sort of security personnel. Just, I think, about 2 weeks ago, one German delegation, German parliament delegation, about four of them, allowed to visit Lhasa. Later, they told, all their visit, all their program fixed, arranged. They have no free
access,
and always company with Chinese security personnel. Such things is useless. The very reason why people go there is to see the reality. Then with Chinese sort of forces, with Chinese intelligent people cannot express freely. So I think that's very, very important. The other day also I mentioned that, please go to Tibet, and sometimes quite expensive, so those people, because of those people who find it a little difficult, then you can borrow some money. Then perhaps you can get some articles, some ancient one in Tibet, then you can sell. So the point is, now China belongs to world. It is absolutely wrong. The Chinese government, headed by hardliner, fool world, is wrong. They cannot fool. The Chinese government, for their own interest, for their own image, must open, must let more people come to Tibet, let them see the reality. If the reality, majority of Tibetan people are really feel happy, then our information, which basis of our struggle, then become wrong. Then we must apologize to the Chinese. Our action is wrong because on the basis of wrong information. If our information is correct, then Chinese policy's basis of information is wrong, then they should apologize. So that's the point now. There is no point to talk with Chinese officials. We want this, we want that. And Chinese say, there's no problem, there's no issue. That's the point. So it's no use to discuss. And let's show world the reality of Tibet. So please ask Chinese missions, you want to go to Tibet and see yourself, and some media people, go there, I think that's very important, not only in a few places, but entire Tibet in different places. You see, some people go to Amdo area, some people go to Akam area, some people go to Yuzhang area, like that. I think that's the only way. Make clear what's the reality. Then if there's no problem, good. Most happy. If there's problem, we have to find ways and means to solve that problem. Like that. And our stand is very clear. We are not seeking separation from People's Republic of China. For our own interest, Tibet, materially backward, spiritually very advanced, culturally also, we quite some today.
Developed.
Not only ancient culture, but also very relevant to today's world. So therefore, if Chinese government allow us meaningful autonomy, implementation of genuine autonomy, which Chinese constitution provided, then we are very much willing to remain within the People's Republic of China for material development, China getting much more sort of developed or economy very successfully. So it is our own interest, like that. So that's our position. And last meeting with Chinese officials. In October, our last meeting, there, as Chinese asked at seventh meeting, at last meeting, that eighth meeting, we sent it all point which we want. So, memorandum in written form, handed over to them. Then, before my delegation reached Dharamsala, the Chinese consular official denounced that memorandum. So now up to them. So now up to world community. You have to judge whether there's problem or not. If there's suffering, there's destruction about Tibet spirit. I think many people, including many scientists, now appreciate about Tibetan knowledge, right? About mind, about emotion. So Tibetan cultural heritage or Tibetan knowledge is something useful for world, for modern world, like that. Now next question.
I think this is the final question here. Do you think spiritual leaders today face more resistance to their teaching than, say, Jesus or Buddha did in their times?
I don't know. I think during Buddha's time and Jesus Christ's time also there's a lot of resistance. I think more resistance than today, I think, at that time. Even Jesus Christ, his own sort of life, you see, then was sacrificed. Buddha's life also, you see, there a lot of resistance from non-Buddhist, and sometimes, you see, argument or debate. And after Buddha also, you see, they... through generations, there's a lot of debate between non-Buddhists and Buddhists. So resistance is not new. But now today, I think generally, I think, I really feel, out of 6 billion human beings, over 6 billion human beings, I think majority are not that much serious about religion. Buddhists also. They may claim, I'm Buddhist. I come from Buddhist family. But in their day-to-day life, not much serious. As a Christian, I think. In the church, there's a few moments they remember God. But outside church, when their real life
begins,
not much bother about religion, about hell or heaven, but more bother about money or power like that, isn't it? So therefore, this is not necessarily, I think, described as a resistance. I think one thing important is, sometimes, even Buddhist tradition also, they fail to bring essential part and make relevance day-to-day life. So religion sometimes, I think firstly, sometimes the people, religion in the form of ceremony and some kasa,
rituals.
And Tibetan case also, sometimes like that. Then they fail to bring the essential. And also the essential part makes relevance day-to-day life. I think that's very important. Ritual, ceremony, that's part of religion, but not that important. Important is the essence. Bring outlook right, correctly. Look, entire human being as in brothers, sisters. Now from theistic viewpoint, because of monotheistic, sorry.
Monotheistic
viewpoint, all come from one source, God. So in true sense, we are brothers, sisters. If you look serious at that, then there's no basis of killing each other, isn't it? Yeah. Then also, you see concept, God, full compassion, infinite compassion, infinite love. So then, faithful person, totally, because of the dedicated your own life to God. So that means you must follow God's example, love, infinite love, compassion. Nobody say our God is so full of anger, full of hatred. Nobody say that, isn't it? If someone say God full of hatred, then better to distance from God. But God described as infinite love, full of compassion, that the more closer with God, the person should be more compassionate. Like that. If we, these are the essential part.
Essential teaching.
So must sort of relevant in our day-to-day life. Then very useful. So that's, I think, important. Thank you. That's all.